Before enabling, your security features make sure that your devices are having enough memory and CPU cores. Okay? So you can see that if you want to really perform cloud lookup for doing URL filtering or for file reputation, then you would require at least one core of CPU, two core of CPU and 8 GB of RAM, and of course 8 GB of boot flash, additional boot flash. If you want to perform on-box lookup, then you should have at least two core of CPUs and of course 16 GB of memory as well as boot flash. That's the additional requirement on your platforms to enable or to perform security app hosting. This is also known as security app. This is also known as security app, which you will have to install onto your Vantage box. And to install that app or that Linux container, you would require that much additional resources. Okay? You can also see the platform supports that much resources. So I was talking about the compliance. So for compliance, we will have to enable like firewall feature, the IPS feature. How to enable? Like, even if you get log into your vManage, let me go through the vManage now quickly. Here you go. This is your vManage. Let me log into it. Just a moment. Let me log in. And let me show you that why do we call it like intent-based security features, or we can enable intent-based security. Why do we say like that? I'll just show you that. Just a moment, please. Okay, here you go. So in this topology, like I do have one vSmart, I do have two Vantage boxes, one vBond, and everything is up and running. So if I go to configuration directly and if I go to the security option. So under security, you can see that we have an option of adding a security policy, add security policy. And before you go ahead and add the security policy, you can see at right top, if you go to right top, then there are couple of options under custom options. So if you expand the custom options, you will get so many options available over there, like lists, firewall, IPS, URL filtering, advanced malware protection, DNS security, umbrella API tokens, threat grid API keys. So in future, if you want to integrate your SD-WAN architecture with Cisco Umbrella platform, you would require umbrella API tokens for that kind of integration. If you have purchased threat grid to perform sandboxing, you will have to provide API keys to perform the integration between your SD-WAN Vantage boxes and the threat grid. And of course, you have some other options available as well, like you can create firewall policies, IPS policies, you could look for them, and also you have a list over here. So if you click on lists, so first of all, it is important for you to create these ones, because it's the same concept that Cisco has brought up here. It's like, you remember that in Cisco IOSs, we used to have zone-based firewalls, okay? We used to have what? Zone-based firewalls. So again, it is a zone-based firewall, but they have added some capabilities over here. Like they have added a capability of application recognition. So it is still a zone-based firewall. It's a stateful firewall. And of course, it is an advanced firewall because it also supports application filtering. Okay. So you can create zones over here. Like for example, if I want to create zones here, so go to zones, create a name zone. Let's say my inside zone, that is VPN 1. Maybe I have another VPN, maybe DMZ zone, that's VPN 2. I have another zone, compliance, that's my VPN 3. Maybe I have a guest VPN, that's guest VPN 10, like that. So I should create zones first of all. And also you can create like whitelist URL, blacklist URLs. You can create signature list. You can create application list that you could leverage later on to perform filtering. By creating firewall policies, you could leverage that, could leverage application list to say, hey, I want to allow all traffic over port 80 and 443, but I want to drop the data for certain applications like Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, like that. Okay? So you can create the application list here, like social media. So like, say Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, like YouTube maybe, at I just created that application list, the customized application list. I can also create like data prefixes over here to match my data. I can also create a domain list I could leverage while creating a DNS policy. So I can create all those lists under custom options. Now let me go back to the security. And over here, we have an option of adding a security policy. So you go ahead and click on add security policy. So these all are the intent-based security policies available here. So for example, if you have a compliant VPN and you want to enable security policy for your compliant VPN, select compliance. So it will ask you to configure firewall and IPS automatically. If you have a guest user, guest VPN, you go ahead and configure firewall as well as the URL filtering for guest access. Same goes with direct cloud access, direct internet access, and finally, you do have an option of custom as well. Like for example, if you have a requirement for compliance, that hey, I also do want to enable URL filtering for compliance. But if you look at here, under compliance, URL filtering is not there. That's why you have an option of the custom. So select custom, say proceed, and thereafter, first of all, it will ask for the firewall policy. So go ahead. Say, I want to create a new policy, so I can provide some names over here. Let's say, APAC firewall policy. Okay, like APAC rule, by default, it's a drop rule. So whatever you want to allow, allow. So like, for example, you could say source data prefix. Either you create those data prefixes under list, or you can just define that over here. Like, hey, if my data source data prefix is 192.168.101.0/24, and just a moment, 101.0/24, and destination data prefix is like 000/0. Thereafter, destination port, let's say port 443. Action, I want to allow, I want to perform inspection, but also I want to say, hey, I want to drop applications. So at the same time, you can say application family list to drop. I can select social media. Let's say, I mean, you know very well that all social media based websites are accessible using port 443 only. So what I've done, hey, if this is my source IP, destination is anything, like I'm creating a firewall rule for an internet over port 443, but at same time, I want to drop data for these applications. The action should be inspected. So say match an action like this. Then you can create multiple rules. Now you would say, sir, there is a drop rule and that is on top of that. I mean, that is on top. What does that mean? Is it something which can drop everything? So no, that's a bug in vManage, that this drop rule will always remain on top of the custom rules that you have created over here. But it doesn't mean that everything will be dropped. No, first it will compare your rules that you have defined here, and finally it will take this drop action. So I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to say pass the default action. I don't want to drop anything. And thereafter, you will have to decide the zone pair, that for which zone you want to apply this policy. So source zone, let's say I had, maybe I had an inside zone, destination zone, maybe a self zone. I can also create multiple zone pairs. If you click on plus, the addition button, you can add multiple zone pairs over it. Maybe inside, then thereafter DMZ, like this. Like this. Okay? Destination zone, this time let me just keep it inside only. Save it. And now I can go ahead and I can save my firewall policy. So within this firewall policy, I could create multiple zone pairs. I could also create multiple rules over here. So now I'll just go ahead and we'll say save firewall policy. So it says only inspect action is allowed for app list. So what I did, let me save this firewall policy. So I've saved this firewall policy now, and thereafter you can go ahead and you can click on next. Now it will ask for IPS policy. So if you really want to create a policy for the IPS feature, you go ahead, create new, For which VPN you want to enable this IPS policy? So target VPN, click on target VPN. Let's say I wanted to enable IPS only for VPN 1. Save changes. Thereafter, provide some policy name like APAC IPS policy. Which signature set you want to use, and there are multiple options like balanced, connectivity, security, so ISAT security, so it will download most number of signatures. And for that purpose, you would require greater memory available on your box. But it will provide you the most security, like it will download approximately 16,000 signatures. Inspection mode is detection or protection. So I said protection because I wanted to enable IPS. If you have a whitelist for your signatures, you can apply that whitelist. That, hey, I don't want to drop the data for these signatures. Also, you could generate a log messages like alerts for errors, maybe for warning like that, or maybe for critical, for info, it's up to you. Thereafter, go ahead, save your IPS policy. Click on next. Then it will ask to enable URL filtering. So to apply or to configure URL filtering, say create new. Target VPN, let's say I wanted to enable URL filtering only for VPN 1. Save changes. Provide policy name. So I set APAC URL filtering. I want to block all these categories, or maybe I want to allow only these categories. So it's up to you what action you want to take. But you can create only one rule. You cannot create multiple rules. Like onto actual proxy servers like WSA or Bluecode proxies, you can go ahead and you can create so many rules for URL filtering. This is allowed, this is not allowed, this is allowed, not allowed, like that. But here you can say either allow or block the web categories. So I want to block all these categories, let's say, like this. Web reputation, which web reputation you want to use, like you want to drop the data only for high risk domains, maybe low risk, trustworthy, ideally it's moderate by default, and that's the recommended one. Under advanced, if you have a whitelist URL, you can create that. Hey, I always want to allow data for all these URLs. Go ahead and create whitelist. If you want to always block data for certain URLs, go ahead and create the blacklist URL list. Okay? Block page content. Like in case if you block some URLs over here, and in case if that end user tries to access that URL that you have blocked using policy. So what end user should see on his or her machine? So for that, you can see default content header over here, like block page content. So even you could also redirect your end user to some other URL. Maybe you have your internal URL saying, hey, you are trying to breach our compliance policy, like that. You can also enable alerts and logging for blacklisted URL, whitelisted, or reputation category, like that. So it's totally up to you. What do you want to enable? But you can create only one rule in one URL filtering policy. If you want to have multiple rules, then you will have to create multiple URL filtering policies. And thereafter, you can call multiple URL filtering policy into a single security policy. So that is also possible. So next. Now it is asking for an advanced malware protection policy. Go ahead and create a new advanced malware protection policy. Target VPN. So by default, it's all for all VPN, but you can say customize VPN. Select custom VPN and thereafter click on target VPN. Let's get this enabled only for VPN 1. Provide some name like APAC. And I want to use a cloud region for N for checking the file reputation, North America. So APJC. I'm going to select APJC because that's the nearest one for APAC users. If you have a license of ThreatGrid, go ahead and get enabled the file analysis. And then select your ThreatGrid, maybe EU, NAM, North America. And then you will also have to provide the API keys for the integration purposes. So now you go ahead and save advanced malware protection policy. Click on next, then it will ask for the DNS security policy, and this is done by the help of Cisco Umbrella platform. So before enabling DNS security policy, we must make sure that we do have a license to the Cisco Umbrella platform. We will have to integrate our Cisco SD-WAN with Cisco Umbrella platform. So if we have both registration tokens to integrate our Cisco SD-WAN with Cisco Umbrella platform, then go ahead and create a security policy for the DNS security. So for target VPN, by default it's all, click on custom. Get it enabled only for the VPN 1 users. DNS server IP is going to be the Umbrella's default IP address. If you want to enable local domain bypass, you get this enabled. I mean, you can, obviously, let's say I'm working for Cisco.com. So if any end user is trying to access any website belongs to Cisco.com domain, then those DNS requests should not be redirected towards Cisco Umbrella platform, because those are trusted domains for me. So I don't want to go to Cisco Umbrella platform for performing DNS resolution for my local domain. So you can perform local domain bypass over here. Provide some name here, let's say APAC, DNS, policy. Over here, you cannot create any policy. You can just perform the integration, nothing more. Policies you will have to create onto Cisco Umbrella platform only. That is something that I'll take you through. Custom VPN configuration, local domain bypass list. Let's say I said asterisk, like I can create the domain list over here, and then I could call that. But I'll have to register myself. So manage Umbrella registration, and then we'll ask for the registration token, and that I can get from Umbrella portal like this. So if you have an Umbrella portal, you go to admin and then you go to API keys and look at the API keys, and then you can copy your API keys from here and then you could paste them. I cannot create the API keys over here. I cannot do that because I do have read-only access at the moment. But if I were having read-write access, then I would have created API keys over there, and then I would have used them onto my vManage to perform registration. Like registration token, I'll have to copy them from Umbrella cloud platform. Okay, so once it is done, thereafter you will go ahead and save this DNS security policy and click on next. Finally, it will ask for the overall security policy name, which contains everything like firewall policy, IPS policy, URL filtering policy, app policy, DNS security policy, everything. So I said APAC security policy. TCP SYN flood limit, you could say that for half open connection, number of sessions, like you could say, hey, maximum half open session must not exceed 500. You could also enable HSL high speed logging, right, for firewall feature only. Thereafter, you can also enable external syslog server for your IPS, URL filtering and app feature, if you really want that. Failure mode is by default open, which means in case if your UTD container, like if your UTD container like Snort engine goes down, remember I told you in beginning, like when I was explaining you the security features, thereafter I told you that hey, to enable all these security features, you will have to have Linux container to be installed onto your Edge boxes. So what if that container itself went down? So that's why you have said failure mode is open or closed. So if it is open, which means if your Linux container goes down, nothing will happen. Like your end user will still continue to have network access. However, firewall rules will still be in place and firewall rules will be applicable accordingly. But your traffic will not get dropped. Like you remember that when you deploy the IPS in your network, like in inline mode or promiscuous mode, remember? So in similar way, you have failure mode over here, like open or close. So don't select close, by default it's open, and keep it open. Go ahead and save policy. So that's how you could create a security policy, and we created a security policy which is a combination of firewall policy, IPS policy, URL filtering policy, And also you could review it in CLI. So in CLI it will look like this. Thereafter, you go to your device template like this, and before going to your device template, you will have to make sure that you have a Linux container image available onto your vManage or onto your CH boxes. So if you go to your CH boxes, let's say, like I do have access to my one of the CSR box, one of my Edge box, log in there. So you don't have to go to your, you don't really have to reach your device to have the CLI access. Or to vManage itself, you can have CLI access. That's a pretty cool feature. So now you say show utility engine standard status. So nothing is there, which means there is no image installed. So there is no image installed onto your Edge box. Now you just have to make sure, that that image is available onto your vManage. To do so, go to administration, and not administration, go to maintenance, and then go to software repository. Go to software repository, and then virtual images. Under virtual images, you must make sure that you do have an image of that app hosting like this. So I have already uploaded that image. You can download this image from the Cisco's image portal, and you just have to upload that over here. Once you have ensured that you have a valid app hosting or UTTS node engine image available onto your vManage, thereafter you go back to your configuration device template. Let's say I have device template for my headquarters, and in headquarters I wanted to enable my security features. Go and edit your device template, like edit. Thereafter go to additional template, and there is an option of security policy. Attach your security policy, and then it will also ask for the container profile. So I'm gonna code the factory default utility template. It is by default there, but also you could create a customized container profile. It is also possible to create a customized container profile. So at the moment, I'm going to utilize the default container profile, like how much resources it will utilize. So under container profile, you will define that how much hardware resources it will consume. And security policy is having all those security features enabled, or all those security features that you have enabled within the security policy. Go ahead and update it. Say next. Now you can click on device and you can see the config difference. It will show you the differences of the config that you are going to deploy onto your box now. You could look for side by side differences, like it is creating a VRF with the name of 65529 automatically for the purpose of installing UDD engine. It is also creating this firewall policy. You can see that it is enabling NAT within that container. You can see all these configurations. So that's your virtual port group. It has allocated IP address automatically. The public IP address is also allocated automatically. The object group it is creating based on your firewall configuration. The perimeter map it is creating automatically since it was a zone-based firewall. It has created zone pair based on your configuration. App hosting, it was having URL filtering, it was having IPS policy, the AMP policy, everything. So you can see this green configuration is going to be pushed on your device now. Now if you click on configure device, it will start deploying this security policy onto your device. However, before deploying the security policy on your device, it will verify, your vManage will verify whether your Edge box is having that Linux container installed or not. If not, then first it will install that Linux container. And post that, it will push the security policy onto your device. So you can see, it's scheduled to be attached when virtual service installation is done. So virtual service is not installed yet. So this configuration is on hold until your LXC, Linux container, gets installed onto your box. Now you can see ongoing processes. So you can see that Alexi container image is getting installed on your Edge box. Once it is installed, thereafter the security policy will get attached to your box automatically. So you can see that everything you can manage from the vManage. You created firewall policy, you created URL filtering policy, IPS policy, advanced malware protection policy, everything you created using vManage, and you got that attached, like you got your security policy attached to your device template now. And also you have seen, since Linux container image was not pre-installed onto your box, therefore your vManage will be responsible to install that. Okay, remember, if you are having, like, there is an ISXE SD-WAN, like SD-WAN capable operating system installed on your vManage box. Now, version does matter. Like, what version of Linux container image you have, and what version of image you are having onto your vManage box. If you are having your operating system of version 17 and Linux container image version is version 16, then those are not compatible, and you will not be able to install Linux container image onto your vManage box. So it might take up to 10-15 minutes for installing this Linux container image onto your vManage box. And remember that there is a bug in Cisco. And what that bug is, that during the installation of Linux container, end users will have outages. Like, end users will not be able to access anything in the network using SD-WAN fabric, SD-WAN architecture. So that is something that you should keep in your mind. Other than that, now since this process is going on, let it going on, and thereafter, I mean, now let's get back to the Cisco Umbrella platform. So Cisco Umbrella platform is something which is really important for us to understand, because in future, now Cisco is going to focus more and more over this cloud-based platform. So basically what it does, like DNS filtering is one of the component, is one of the service provided by the Cisco Umbrella platform. DNS, I'm repeating my line. DNS filtering is one of the service provided by the Cisco Umbrella platform. You can also utilize Cisco Umbrella platform as a secure internet gateway for web filtering, also as a firewall. And even if you go to the policies, you can see that you can create three different types of policies. DNS policies to perform DNS filtering, firewall policy to perform firewall filtering, and web policies to perform web filtering. Now, for DNS filtering, it is very easy to perform integration. As we saw, that we just needed to provide the API tokens to perform integration. However, to utilize the firewall policy and web policies, it is mandatory for us to redirect entire end user traffic to the Cisco Umbrella platform. And that can be done using IPsec tunnels only. So if I go back, and if I take you through my presentation once again, especially for the Umbrella, Cisco Umbrella, so you can see over Cisco Umbrella, you can have visibility, the protection at the DNS layer, web filtering, file inspection, and threat intel access, and of course the control. So it does provide all these services. So where does Cisco Umbrella fit? Like, first line of security, which starts with the DNS filtering, because as soon as end user is making a DNS request for accessing any domain, those DNS requests will be intercepted by the vManage box and will be sent over the Cisco Umbrella platform. And you saw that over Cisco Umbrella platform, we can create the policies. We can create the DNS policies over here. And like, if you add a new policy, you could define that, hey, for all these domains, like you could see, for all these domains, I want to block the DNS responses. Fine, you do that. But this is where you will be creating the DNS policies. And those policies will be applicable to your end users sitting behind SD-WAN vManage boxes. So that's easy. the integration between Cisco Umbrella and the SD-WAN for the DNS security or for the DNS filtering is very easy.